Good morning. It's so good to see you, and it is so good to be able to spend this time together to worship God, to reflect on His Word, to bring our hearts to Him in prayer. I'd like to start this morning with Psalm 96 and read it to you. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless His name. Bring with great joy the message of His salvation from day to day. Declare with all your heart His glory among the nations, His wonders and miracles among the people. For the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. He is to be revered and honored above all other gods. For all the gods of the peoples are idols, but the Lord God made the heavens. Honor and majesty are before Him. Strength and beauty are in His refuge. Give to the Lord, O you of every nation and of all people, give to the Lord glory and strength. Give to the Lord the glory due His name. Bring an offering and come into His courts. Oh, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Dance before Him, all the earth. Say to those who don't know Him, the Lord reigns. The world also shall be established, and it shall not be moved. He shall judge the people righteously. Let the heavens rejoice, and let the earth be glad. Let the sea roar and the fullness of it. Let the field be joyful, and all that's in it. Then shall all the trees of the woods rejoice before the Lord. For he comes to judge the earth. He shall judge the world with righteousness and the people with His truth. Isn't that a beautiful psalm? So many ideas and thoughts. I wanted to speak a little bit about a couple of the Hebrew words that really sang to me when I read this psalm and was preparing for this morning. The first Hebrew word that I'd like to bring to your attention is the word sing. It's the word shir in Hebrew, and it means to sing out, to express thoughts in poetic form. to sing lyrics, to sing a poem, a song with ideas. It's a word that to me just causes me to quiver and to dance inside, to sing a new song to the Lord. The other command that we are given there was the word give. And that word in Hebrew is the word yahab. And it does indeed mean give or bring or offer. But it has the idea of opening up. The idea of opening up your heart. Opening up your mind. Opening up your ears to hear Him, to hear the Lord. That's what He asks of us, that we would just listen, that we would just trust and believe in Him. So, indeed, sing to the Lord a new song and give to the Lord every nation, every people, all tongues and languages throughout the earth. Give to Him glory and strength. Would you join me in prayer as we go into worship? Holy Father, Your name is truly great. It is higher than the heavens, and it is beyond our comprehension or understanding. You are the great and mighty one, El Shaddai, El Elyon, God Most High. You are our salvation. You are our refuge and sanctuary. You care for us, and You provide all. Thank You, Father. Will You come with us and dance with us as we in our hearts sing and dance to You and praise Your name? Amen. Will you join me in this hymn by Charles Wesley, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing? This hymn is Morning Has Broken.
Sweet the rains new fall, sweet the rains new fall.
This is my father's world.
And rise, I am blessed.
Come thou font of every blessing, a hymn asking the blessing of God to come and rest on us indeed. Let's go and look at the Word of God. I'd like to start with a reading from Exodus chapter 19. I've been reflecting lately. How do we contemplate the incomprehensible? I picked up a book by a man named Andy Minch. He is a PhD linguist and a Bible translator for Wycliffe Bible Translators. He's also a nationally and internationally renowned linguist and a consultant to nations regarding linguistics and the use of language. And I've been contemplating and reflecting myself on language and how it kind of limits our thinking. Here's a quote from Dr. Minch. There are times throughout our lives when what we want to communicate is so rich, so personal, so precious, that mere words cannot express the depth of meaning we want to communicate. We are immersed in a world of words and language. We are so dependent on them for our knowledge and information about the world, that sometimes mere language can actually be a limitation to our understanding. We must use these earthbound, finite words to comprehend divine things. I really liked that quote because in preparing and reflecting on Exodus 19, and really the incredible miracle that the Jews record in the traditions of the fathers occurred, that I kind of was blown away. And the day that I was reading this for the first time this year, I was undone. I realized that these words were the best words that translators from Hebrew could use, and they were the best words that could be used to express things that are inexpressible and incomprehensible. But let me read. Exodus 19. On the third new moon after the people of Israel had gone out of the land of Egypt, on that day, they came into the wilderness of Sinai. They set out from Rephidim and came into the wilderness of Sinai, and they encamped in the wilderness. There, Israel encamped before the mountain, while Moses went up to God. The Lord called to him out of the mountain, saying, "Thus shall you say to the house of Jacob, and tell the people of Israel, you yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my commands, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the people of Israel." I think, and perhaps we can imagine, that God is truly speaking and attempting to tell his people, Israel, his children, how much he loves them. Listen to those words. "I bore you up on eagle's wings," like an eagle mother bears her young, literally on her wings, to protect them from things from below. And how is it God protects us? And how he promises that they, his people, would be a treasured possession and a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. He loves these people. They're flawed. They're not perfect. So Moses came and called the elders of the people and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. All the people answered together and said, "All that the Lord has spoken, we will do." And Moses reported the words of the people to the Lord. And the Lord said to Moses, "Behold, I am coming to you in a thick cloud, that the people may hear when I speak with you, and may also believe you forever." On the morning of the third day, there were thunders and lightnings, and a thick cloud on the mountain, and a very loud trumpet blast, so that all the people in the camp trembled. When I read that in English, it sounds like it was terrifying and scary. But when I read that as I was preparing to bring these words to you, I had a bit of an understanding and a vision. What if the people of Israel that day when the Lord himself spoke to them that they could hear, what if it was his love? What if they saw his love, heard his love, tasted his love, felt his love, even could smell it? I was thinking, if I could do those things, I think love would taste like chocolate. It would smell like a rose. I can't even imagine and think about what it might look like or sound like. But when I think of that, that's what I felt as I read those words. The Lord came in his love for his people, a love that surpasses knowledge, a love that cannot be expressed. It is truly incomprehensible and inexpressible. It's not contingent. It's sticky. It's just there. And everything it touches blooms and comes to life. Then Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet God, and they took their stand at the foot of the mountain. Now that particular statement, the Jews and the traditions of the fathers say that the mountain was over their heads. A miracle, a thing that truly defied the laws of physics as we understand them. I suppose if you think of particle physics and you think of quantum physics, then indeed this might be possible, but this would have been nothing we'd ever seen before. And in the Jewish tradition, the rabbis teach that God had the people pray and the mountain moved. You might remember that Jesus said to the people in the first century when he was in Israel, in the region of Judea, he said, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you can tell this mountain to move. And the people of that time, those Jews who heard him with their own ears, would have known this story. Now Mount Sinai was wrapped in smoke because the Lord had descended on it in fire. The smoke of it went up like the smoke of a kiln, and the mountain trembled greatly. And as the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder, Moses spoke, and God answered him in thunder. The Lord came down on Mount Sinai to the top of the mountain, and the Lord called to Moses to the top of the mountain, and Moses went up. What if, as I said, this was truly in the hearing of all Israel, in the sight of all Israel, a love so great it caused them to tremble? It doesn't say they trembled with fear. It just said that they trembled. They were moved so greatly in their being, the love of the Lord. The word of God, the living word given for us on that day at Mount Sinai. Not only did God give his word on Mount Sinai, but he also sent himself, his own son, in the form of a man who emptied all his splendor, all his treasure, and descended from heaven, just like the Lord descended from heaven atop to Mount Sinai. Our Lord Jesus, he came. He came from heaven, and he dwelt among us. And he was obedient to his Father, obedient to death, for our sakes. Indeed, he has become our salvation. The Lord is our salvation. He is our peace. He is our place of rest. He is the Holy One of Israel, and he has come for all people, all who believe in his name, all that he is, life, joy, peace, forgiveness, grace, the incomprehensible, the inexpressible, the Almighty God. He came to the people of Israel and all that were there, perhaps as many as 3 million people, heard him speak. And he comes to us today to touch our hearts. We too can hear him speak to our hearts. It is indeed my prayer that he would speak to each one of us as we worship him and as we contemplate his love. It's a love I can't express, but it is a love that forgives all. It is a love that does not remember any of our sin or iniquity. It is a love that takes us just as we are, as if we never. He loves us. He wants us to know. He wants us to feel and to taste and to see and to smell and to hear his love. And may he make that so for each of us. Amen. This hymn is called, How Great Thou Art. The words are beautiful. Let me read you the first verse. O Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds your hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed.
Take it in, and on that cross, take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee.
This hymn is a prayer. It's called Breathe on Me, Breath of God. This hymn is called Amazing Grace by John Newton, a great favorite that hopefully you know the words and you can at least hum along. Join me.
Yeah.
thousand years, bright shining as the sun.
Would you recite with me, if you're able, the Lord's Prayer? Recite it as you know it. There are differences between denominations. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This last hymn is called God Be With You Till We Meet Again. If you do know the words, will you please sing it with me? With you till we meet again.
God be with you till we meet again. Wise counsels guide upon you. With his sheep securely fold you. God be with you till we meet again. To we meet, God.
Thank you so much for coming this morning. It has been wonderful to be with you in worship. Look forward to seeing you again soon.